Please keep quiet. You want me that I should talk to you in English. I shall obey your command. But take it from me that it will not be long before you yourself will have to speak in our own national language. If you don't do that, then you will drag the country behind, and we have to march forward. Therefore, you must all make up your mind that we have to put our maximum effort to go forward. And unless you do that, I'm afraid you will suffer. You know that after a prolonged struggle, the country has got freedom. But it is not the freedom of the kind that we want. It is not the freedom of the kind that the deliverer of the country expected. And to our shame, we have to confess that we, by our folly, lost him who was responsible for our deliverance. Now, after his going, we must pay penance and at least try our best to be fit to deserve the freedom that he has obtained for us. You know that free India is only a child of a year and a half. It has yet to learn to walk, and it has to grow, it has to be strong, and its future depends upon how we build it today. Therefore, we have to nurse it carefully, and we have to feed, clothe, and strengthen it properly. How can we do it? And what are we going to do for it? You must remember that it is our great good fortune that we have in our lifetime got an opportunity which few people get in lifetime to build our own country in our own fashion. And the future history will record what we are doing today. So it is up to you to realize what is our responsibility and what the country needs today. The first requisite of building a strong, free India is unity and peace. If there is no unity in the country, then the country is bound to go down. And therefore, we must first adjust our differences in such a manner and behave in such a manner that there would be complete harmony and peace in the country. You cannot expect the government continuously to maintain peace by force. It would be an evil day when in this country the government would have to use permanently repressive measures. Today, we are passing through a previous period of crisis, and our young men have not, in their impatience, not realized that a freedom which has been obtained with great difficulty is likely to be lost or likely to give no benefit, no advantage, if we do not appreciate that our present duty is to unite and consolidate our forces. We lost our leader because we forgot that very first lesson. And even after his going, if we do not realize that in unity lies our strength, then we'll have greater misfortune. I hope and trust that the country has learned a good lesson from that. Now, as I say, the first requisite is unity and peace. For unity, we must forget what religion we belong to, what caste we belong to. But we must believe that we are all Indians and that we are all equal. There can be no distinction between men and men in a free country. All must have equal opportunities. All must have equal rights. All must have equal responsibility. It is a good thing to say so, but it is a difficult thing to put into practice. And therefore, we must continuously strive towards that end. Now, the other thing we have to do is that for peace and order in this country, for a few years at least, till we are able to stand on our own legs, we must forget that we can every now and then, for our objective, continuously give that to the government. We cannot do anything if a government is being challenged day after day for groups of people who want their own way. It may be that what they want may be, according to their own thinking, honestly, very good. But in this country, since Gandhiji came, he put before you an ideal that we must obtain what we want by peace, by peaceful methods, by truth, and by non-violence. But if people every now and then begin to threaten and challenge the government's authority, and to dethrone it or to overthrow it or to gain it their own objective by force, then that government would not be able to do anything. Now, we have seen that forces are arising in this country which would create chaos and disorder, as a result of which, instead of strengthening the country, we would weaken it. You have therefore to think what is our responsibility. You have seen the government is dealing with the RSS movement. They are our own people. And they want that there should be Hindu Raj or Hindu culture should be imposed by force. No government can tolerate it. Because you must understand that there are as many Muslims in this country as are in the partition country. And we are not going to drive them away by force. It would be an evil day if we started that game in spite of partition and whatever happened. We must change our mental outlook. And we must understand that they are going to stay here and that it is our obligation, it is our responsibility, it is our duty to make them feel that this is their home, this is their country, it is their responsibility, their obligation to discharge their duties according as citizens of this country. We must both understand that partition is a thing of the past. It has come to stay, and honestly I believe it is good for both of us that they don't come back. Because it would be a perpetual source of trouble and quarrel. Whatever may be the reason, and I honestly believe the reason is the slavery of 200 years and the power that stayed for a long period for its own convenience created a situation for easy rule, easy administration, in which we began to go far away from each other. It is good that we have agreed to partition in spite of all its evils. I have never repented for my agreeing to partition because I had myself experienced during the period of 1 year's joint administration that if we had not agreed to partition, we would have grievously erred and repented. India would not have resulted in a partition of two countries, but would have been partitioned into several bits. And therefore, whatever some people may say, I am convinced, and I remain convinced, that it has become for the good of the country that we have agreed to partition. Now, after partition, we had a huge problem. And those who partitioned the country with our agreement had mental reservations. And they thought that partition into two is not the last word. And they started the game immediately after partition. They went to Junagadh in the midst of Kathiawar state, where nearly half the number of Indian states are located. In the middle of that group, they took Junagadh and got an accession in Pakistan. It was the first sign, danger signal, for dividing India again. And we saw the game. Fortunately for us, we woke up in time, and those who tried that game saw that we are not sleeping. Then you saw the Kashmir trouble simultaneously. There also, although there were many difficulties, the government of India, with all its difficulties and impediments, got the situation under its control rapidly. And I should say, we have enhanced our reputation by sending our army there, which has, in spite of its Indianization completely, has proved its mettle and has proved its worth. It is a great thing that immediately after partition of the army and partition of the country, our army, manned absolutely by our own people, showed by their strategy, by their valor, by their organizing ability, that it can stand comparison with any army in the world. It is a great gain. Then, you had your labor, which gave you long sleepless nights. Often, your prime minister and your presidents were angry with us and thinking that we are neglecting South and that we are heading for a disaster. They hardly knew our difficulties and our plans. These plans can't be exposed. You know the pictures that were painted. If Hyderabad was attacked, or if Hyderabad attacked, you know, we had to make preparations all over India so that there may be no trouble anywhere in India. And you also know now by the result that what we predicted was true, that you wait and you will see that we perform the operation in such a manner that there may not be any bleeding, or if there is any bleeding, it may be the least possible bleeding. Now, that is what we have shown in the first year of our freedom. Please don't pull our legs. We will not betray you. Trust us. You are impatient. You want more wages for the labor. What do we want? Do we want to starve labor? Why? Are we foreigners? Are we businessmen? Some people say we are capitalist agents. Yes. I have said so and I say it now, that since I joined Mahatma Gandhi, one thing I learned from him, that a public man, if he has to have its proper place, he shouldn't keep any property. And I can challenge any socialist or any communist to play the game with me. I am prepared. But my quarrel is the second part of Mahatma's advice they give up. That is, they want to use violence. That is my quarrel. No terrorism amongst ourselves. So long as you are using that game, either underground, overground, wherever it was, when we were under a foreign power, we made allowances for it. And we are paying for it also. Because an evil once tolerated grows. And that is what we see in Hyderabad. Why are these communists creating trouble? How did they grow? Because the Hyderabad government was foolish enough to allow it to grow for its own safety, for its own security. And we had no control then to suppress them. And what is it that we see there? In 3-4 months' time, 200 or more than 200 young congressmen, their own brothers, have been murdered. Is that a sign of freedom? That in the first year of freedom, you have 200 congressmen in a small area one after another, killed in cold blood. And once they are driven out from that area, where are they to go? Inside your border. They will harass you. They will have the same thing, same game with you. What are we to do? Therefore, to the communists, my appeal may be in vain, because they don't listen to any of you. I told them immediately after my release from jail last time that I am prepared to take all the communists in the Congress, provided, and I am prepared to forget the past and keep the doors open, provided they give up this method of violence. And they give up their inspiration from foreign countries.